Tell me about the Magic Circle.
So the Magic Circle is the story of a legendary piece of vaporware. It's a game that has taken more than 20 years for the developers to not finish. And you, the hero of this broken game, realize that the only way that anything's ever going to change is if you start to basically wander off their non-existent script and steal the tools of design from them and basically ship their game from the inside. That's it in a nutshell. You get these abilities early on to trap and edit creatures and objects that make up the game. And when you do that, you can jump inside them, see these rules that drive them, which are kind of Lego-like behaviors. You can rip anything out of one thing and put it inside anything else, which allows you to solve sort of obstacles and problems in a really open-ended, free-form way.
So it's interesting that this game has such like a message to it, and you're also building really complex mechanics. Tell me about how important it was to kind of keep it really mechanics-driven.
At Question feel like player input is obviously the interactivity element of games is very important to us. And so empowering player freedom, we've been making games a long time. I used to work at Irrational. I worked on Bioshock 1 and Bioshock Infinite. And Jordan, who I started the company with, he also worked on all three Bioshocks. Kane Shin, our programmer, used to work at Arkane. He was one of the lead AI guys on Dishonored. So giving the player a broad tool set and allowing them to get creative with that tool set, we've always found really interesting. In those games, it was usually in a combat sort of scenario. And we thought doing that with a puzzle game could be really cool. And especially thematically, a game about sort of an unfinished game and getting the player to sort of exist almost as a sort of like design-like presence inside that game. Really meshed well with the story we were trying to tell.
If you're working on at Irrational, I mean, I don't know if you want to name names, but blink twice if Ken Levine is the antagonist.
He's definitely not. He's definitely not. It's not about Ken. It's really, our rule was we had to be guilty personally of anything that was in the game. It was really about us and our failings as developers and something we've seen universally. I mean, it's the characters in the game are hyper-exaggerated, obviously, but they are human, and we always feel like that a lot of the problems that we encounter as developers are because we're human, and we have human failings. And so it was sort of giving people an exaggerated peek behind the curtain of the way that we as developers can sort of get paralyzed and fail, and really anybody doing anything creative. It's tough. It's tough to make those decisions, and the bigger the game and the more people involved, the harder that gets. And it was sort of, you know, a way to sort of explore that relationship that creators have with their games, that gamers have with creators, and that gamers have with the games, and the way all that plays into sort of, you know, the way games are today.
When you guys were working on the art style of this game, you know, it's kind of towing that line between, like, it's got its own look, but it also has to look unfinished. How did you guys kind of play with that?
Yeah, I mean, the original idea of the game before it became what it is now was sort of about developers arguing over a whiteboard. And so that gave me the sort of germ of an idea for the look. And then as I started building that out, I realized I could do something that I'd never quite seen before and also I thought was visually really striking. And then as the game became about an unfinished game, it still lived in that sort of concept art space, which allowed me to do something that I thought looked really cool, but very clearly communicated, not done. So that was really the goal. And people seem to get that, which is awesome.
I think it's really interesting that you guys are putting this out now. I mean, it's so relevant with, you know, early access being a thing and, you know, kind of making this commentary about game development.
Well, I feel like it's early access and the way that early access has been used and the way that gamers have, and players have sort of encountered early access has made the game relevant in ways that we probably couldn't even have predicted when we started it. Because I know early access was a thing back then, but it hadn't quite gained some of the notoriety that it has now. I mean, some gamers are fairly gun-shy about early access. We found that when we were in early access, that a lot of people were like, oh, I just don't do early access anymore. So I think, especially on the, you know, the PC, Mac, Linux sort of spectrum, people who have access to early access, probably more than others, are sort of familiar with, you know, encountering broken, unfinished stuff, you know. And the great thing about early access is that's all up front. You know, if you buy a game in early access, you know what you're getting. You know, so but it does give people sort of even more insight into what that's like.
So how can people get their hands on the game?
Ah, yes. Well, the game is available on Steam, on Windows, Mac, and Linux. And it will, you can get a free demo, which will save your progress. And, or, you know, it's $20 and you can just, you can find it there.